Chapter 15, Vacation and a Reunion. Sunagakure. Gaara had finished the last piece of the mnemonic paperwork before getting up from his desk and looked out the window. "Anbu," said Gaara with his husky voice as a masked ninja appeared behind him. "What is it, Kazekage-sama?" the ninja asked as he bowed before Gaara. "Could you bring me Temari?" Gaara ordered as his eyes never left the window. "I would like to talk to her about something personal." The Anbu nodded and left in a swirl of sand while Gaara remained at the window. A few minutes had passed as Temari entered the office, slightly out of breath, and said, "Are you all right, Gaara?" The blonde saw her youngest brother staring out the window and knew what the redhead was thinking. "How long has it been since Naruto's banishment and supposed death?" Gaara began as he looked out the window as the villagers went about on their day. "3 years?" "Yes, Gaara," Temari sadly answered as she remembered the blonde who brought back her brother. "Even though Kankuro and I haven't interacted with him as much as you have, but we know how much you miss him and we own him so much for bringing back our baby brother." Gaara turned to look at his sister and said, "Even though we know that he is alive and out there somewhere, I miss my friend dearly. He had shown me the true meaning of existing as he too shares my burden." Temari remembers clearly how much her baby brother thought of her fellow blonde and even remembered the heartache that Gaara had gone through when learning that Naruto had died. "Thank Kami that Naruto's still alive," Temari happily thought. "Now if only we could find him." "I think it would be beneficial if I took some time off," Gaara said as he sat at his desk and leaned back on the chair. "I've heard that Yugakure is lovely this time of year." Temari stumbled on her tongue in shock before she said, "Are you sure about this, Gaara? I mean, as Kazekage, you really can't take much time off because of your responsibilities." The blonde then saw that look in Gaara's eyes and knew that her brother needed this more than the Kazekage. "But as your sister," Temari continued, "I think Baki-sensei will be alright with handling affairs here while we find a nice place for a vacation." Gaara let out a hum before he said, "We should ask for an escort from Konoha and have it as an E-rank mission." Temari smiled as she knew her brother was happy with the decision as she prepared a messenger to be sent to Konohagakure before she summoned Kankuro for a small family meeting. Konohagakure. Tsunade was working through some of the paperwork on her desk as she thought of everything that has happened in the past 3 years after Naruto's banishment. The meeting with the Lion's summons and meeting Steven Universe, Sasuke Uchiha's disappearance, and most recently a former member of Denzo's root organization appearing at the gates. Sai, as the boy had called himself, had revealed that Denzo had discovered a powerful gemstone and implanted it into one of their volunteers before his death at the hands of the subject. Sai had also said that he was lucky enough to have escaped after the Warhawk's death as the gemstone supposedly has the power to absorb not only chakra but a person's life force along with it and other untold powers. Tsunade wasn't sure to be glad that Danzo had finally met his end or concerned of the person who had killed the Warhawk. "Naruto," Tsunade thought as she set the stamp to the side and turned the chair around to look out the window towards the village. "Ever since you were banished things have gone downhill and it was all because of those fools who were responsible for this." A knock on the door made Tsunade turn her chair back around and called out to whoever was on the other side to enter. Asuna Shinobi had entered and pulled out a scroll as he said, "We have a mission from the Kazekage. This scroll has the details of the mission and the requirements." Tsunade took the scroll and dismissed the Shinobi as she then looked over the details. "This is most likely an A-ranked mission, but who should I send?" The Hokage thought as Konoha was on shaky grounds with Suna because of Naruto's banishment. "I cannot send just a regular team of shinobi, but the Rookies and their senseis are out on missions." The sound of the door opening alerted Tsunade as she soon saw a familiar Isor and his team enter. "Team Gay has completed their mission of capturing a group of bandits," Gay announced as he handed in his report while his three students stood behind him. The three members of Team Gay and the rest of the Rookie Nine had become stronger over the past 3 years with all of them reaching Chunin with Neji becoming a Jonin. Neji was now wearing the tradition Hyuga robes with a dark gray apron tied to his waist. Tenden was wearing a long-sleeved blouse, red pants, and bandages around her waist while a large scroll was hanging from her back. Aside from Gay, Lee had hardly changed his appearance with the exception of the chunin vest he wore. Tsunade smirked as she then thought, looks like I had just found the team I needed. Unknown location. Inside a dark corridor, a shadowed figure sat on his throne as a shinobi donning a blank mask kneeled before him. Our spy has given us his monthly report, said the shinobi as the figure let out a hum. He has also revealed that a team from Konohagakure will be sent out on a mission given to them by the Keizukage. What do you wish for us to do? The figure looked at the shinobi before him and said, do not do anything yet at the moment, but continue to monitor the Keizukage in the possibility that he or the team may reveal vital information. Report back to me immediately if any key information is discovered. Fail or disobey my orders and your life will be forfeit. Understood, my lord, said the shinobi before he left the room. The figure stood up from his throne and headed towards the nearby room where more shinobi wearing the same blank masks stood. You three, said the figure as he pointed to a few of the shinobi, I will need you for my training session. The trio that the figure motioned to followed the figure, ready for the fate before them. Tsunagakure. A few days had passed as Gaara, his siblings, and Baki were in the office when the team from Konoha entered. So this is the team Konoha could spare? Asked Konkuro as he looked at Team Gay before Temari jabbed him with her elbow. I thank you for accepting this mission, said Gaara as he was wearing dark green pants and a long red coat. As the scroll had stated, my siblings and I are going on a small vacation to a place outside the elemental countries. No one but the sailors themselves know what lies outside our countries, as some have mentioned that the technology out there is beyond our own and that no one there possesses any form of chakra. Even so, do not let your guard down in any event. Gay stood before Gaara and said, do not worry Keizukage-sama, Team Gay will ensure that you and your siblings will be safe during this mission. Gaara nodded as he looked at his siblings and motioned for everyone to get ready for the trip ahead. Please stay safe, Gaara, Baki thought as he began working in the Keizukage's stead. Beach City, Docks. A few days had passed with a group standing around on the small boat as a man in a yellow raincoat was piloting the boat. The guy said that it's not too long till we reach the place, said Konkuro as he pointed ahead. He even said that if we look, we can see the place. Everyone looked to see the awaiting city and were surprised to see that it was different than where they have been before. The boat stopped at the docks and allowed the group to step onto the docks with Team Gay looking around to be sure that things were safe. This place does look nice, Temari said as she looked around at some of the businesses nearby. A screech was heard as the ninjas looked to see something in the far-off distance as Neji said, guess getting a tour will have to wait. Lee, Neji, said Gay as he looked at his students, go investigate while Tin and I protect the Keizukage and his siblings. The two were about to leave when Temari unsealed her fin and said, I'll go with you as backup. Neji looked at Gaara, who then gave him a nod with a slight menacing look in his eyes. Come on, let's go, said Neji as he, Lee, and Temari left to investigate while Lee silently prayed for them to stay safe. Beach City, Crystal Temple. The trio arrived to see a giant centipede-like creature that had a huge jaw, an eye inside the jaw, a white mane, and green crystals on its back, and it was fighting. The creature were four figures, three of them were girls while one was a young boy. One woman had dark skin and her hair in a cube-shaped afro as she was wearing a red and black bodysuit and pink shades, using a pair of red gauntlets to grapple with a set of large, dangerous pincers. Another was a slim girl with a bird-like look to her as she had a pointed nose and a pearl in her forehead, and she was wearing a teal kimono-like outfit and orange shorts, and she was using a spear to stab at the monster. The last girl was odd to the group as she had purple skin with whitish-purple hair and an amethyst resting on her breasts, wearing a purple sleeveless shirt and black pants that had stars cut out at the knees, while she used a whip with purple shards to tangle the creature's legs. The young boy had curly black hair and he was wearing a red shirt with a yellow star in the middle, blue jeans, and pink sandals, and he was using a pink shield to bash smaller versions of the larger centipede. We could use some help, Steven, said the purple girl as she tightened her grip. Sorry, said the boy as he used the shield to protect himself when one of the creatures sprayed a green liquid towards him, but these guys got my hands full. The slender girl jumped towards the boy, whom the group believed to be Steven, and used her spear to smack some of the small creatures away. "Thanks, Pearl," said Steven as he bit his thumb and weaved some hand seals, summoning Jutsu. The boy slammed his hand into the ground as a lion with pink fur and mane appeared in a cloud of smoke before it began to attack the smaller creatures. Seeing the group before them slowly getting overpowered, Lee said, "We must help them." Nujai nodded as he activated his Byakugan and then said, "Indeed, but remember that we must ensure the safety of the Kazekage's sibling." Before Nujai could formulate a plan, Lee rushed into the battle as Temari opened her large fan and said, "Your friend seems just as energetic as before. You have no idea," the Hyuga thought to himself as he rushed to the aid of Steven and the lion. Using his gentle fist, Nujai was able to destroy the small creatures as they disappeared in clouds of mist and smoke. "Thanks," said Steven as he pointed to the larger monster, "but you need to get out of here. That mother centipede is really dangerous." "I am aware of the situation," Nujai responded as he saw Lee charge towards the larger beast and gave it a powerful kick to its underside. "We are on a mission that has apparently crossed over into your battle." With Lee, the Taijutsu specialist had delivered a fury of attacks and landed on the sand as the purple girl appeared next to him. "What are you doing here?" the girl asked with urgency. "You need to get out of here." "I'm afraid that I cannot, as my team and I are on a mission to protect the Kazekage and his siblings, and this unmouthful creature might cause harm to the Kazekage," Lee countered as he took a look at the girl and was stunned by what he saw. The girl had a face that showed great determination in her eyes and a playful nature in her smirk. Her hair was like looking at snow during a sunset that gave it a beautiful purple light to it. Lee thought as the sweat on the girl's skin made her sparkle in the sun beautifully and her hair flowing through the wind, giving her the appearance of an angel. "She's beautiful. Look out!" the girl cried out as she pushed Lee away to prevent the Taijutsu specialist from getting sprayed by some green liquid. Seeing the liquid melting a few of the rocks in the sand, Nujai called out to Temari and Lee as he said, "Watch out for the acid it sprays." The rest of Team Gay and the Suna siblings arrived as Tenen approached Lee and said, "Get it together, Lee. You were lucky that girl saved you." Lee chuckled sheepishly as he said, "A thousand pardons, Tenen. I just got distracted." The ninja got into their respective battle stances and were about to help the women and Steven when all of a sudden, gym style, hooking claw. Two golden chains suddenly appeared from above the creature and wrapped themselves around the monster's mouth, clamping it shut. A new figure appeared on top of the giant creature with the golden chains coming from two square-shaped gems above his wrists, with the figure trying to hold on as the beast began to thrash about. "It can't be," said Tenten as she took a closer look at the new figure with shock and surprise. "But it is," said Nujai as his Byakugan revealed the figure wearing black swimming short with orange kanji for fox, black sandals, an orange button-up shirt with yellow sun's designs scattered on it, and a hitai 8 with a red cloth and a golden star attached to the metal plate that held up the figure's spiky blonde hair, Naruto. Naruto held tightly onto the chains in an attempt to let the centipede wear itself out, but the creature kept thrashing about. "All right, Naruto," cheered the purple girl as Team Gay and the Suna siblings watched in awe at how Naruto was fighting the creature. "Ride him, cowboy." The centipede struggled until it finally got loose of the chains and tossed Naruto into the air. Seeing the balloon flying up into the air, Gaara was about to act when he felt a hand on his shoulder. The Kazekage looked to see the woman in red looking at Naruto as she said, "Stay back, my son knows what he's doing. But he could get seriously hurt," said Tenten until the slim girl approached and pointed towards Naruto. Tenten looked to see a quick flash of light as Naruto, now wearing golden clawed gauntlets with spikes traveling up his arms before stopping, a golden shoulder pauldrons that were in the shape of fox heads. The girl stared at both the beautiful and the intimidating look that the talons possessed before seeing Naruto dive towards the creature. "Gym style," said Naruto as he crossed his arms before pulling his arms back, launching a few golden spikes at the creature, crystal needles. The spikes were jammed into the creature's flesh as the beast let out a screech of pain while Naruto had a golden orb glowing in his hand. "Time for the finisher," said Naruto as he slammed the orb into the back of the creature's head. Gym style, golden Rasengan. Everyone shielded their eyes as a bright light shone, with the creature letting out a final screech. After the light had died down, everyone looked to see Naruto standing where the creature once stood, holding a large green gem in his claws, and the giant creature nowhere to be seen. "Now that's handled, fault with," said Naruto as the large gem was encased in a golden bubble, "how about we get some pizza, as I've worked up quite the appetite." "Naruto," said Tenten, getting the attention of the blonde, "I can't believe that it's really you." Naruto looked to see Team Gay and the Suna siblings and asked, "What are you guys doing here?"
"We should be asking you the same question," said Konkuro, as he was shocked to see Naruto not only standing before him, but how the blonde was fighting. "Where did you get those awesome claws, and who taught you how to fight like that?"
"We did," said the woman in red, as her large gauntlets vanished with the others, and Naruto doing the same with their weapons. "We are the Crystal Gems. I am Garnet, leader of the Crystal Gems." The purple girl used a hand to move some of her hair out of her face as she said, "Name's Amethyst, and your friend's lucky that I got him out of the way before that centipede turned him into a puddle of goo." Lee bowed towards Amethyst, giving her his thanks, as the slim girl then curtsied.
"I'm Pearl," said the girl as she lovingly took Naruto's hand into hers. "I'm just glad that my boyfriend was able to handle a centipedal mother while keeping damage to a minimal." Naruto kissed the pearl on Pearl's forehead and said, "Was there any doubt, Haim?"
"Hey Gay," said Steven as he looked at said ninja, "haven't seen you since Lion's dad held that meeting." Gay smiled as he said, "It is really nice to meet you too, Steven Universe, and I must say that you've grown quite a bit since then." It was true, as Steven was now taller and slightly slimmer than he was 3 years ago. Steven chuckled as he was standing next to Garnet with his height reaching the gym's waist and said, "Well, I did have a bit of a growth spurt, and the training we've been doing had helped." Gay then looked at the Crystal Gems and said, "It is very nice to meet all of you. Allow me to introduce myself and the others. I am Miaido Gay, leader of Team Gay and Taijutsu Master of Konohagakure." Gay then pointed to his three students as he continued, "These three are my lovely students, Tenten, Nejai, and Lee. Tenten specializes in weapons, Nejai is a prodigy from the Hyuga clan, and Rock Lee is my personal student in the art of Taijutsu." Gay then pointed to the Suna siblings and was about to introduce them when Temari said, "I'll take care of our introductions. I'm Temari, and these two here are Konkuro and Gaara, my brothers. Konkuro is the one with the makeup. It's war paint." Konkuro shouted as Gaara slowly approached Naruto and hugged the blonde.
"It is good to see you again, my friend," said Gaara as he ended the hug. "I've missed you, as you were the first one to understand my pain and become my friend."
Naruto smiled as he offered a hand, with Gaara shaking it, while the blonde said, "It's good to see that you're doing all right, Gaara. So what brings you here anyway?" Gaara smiled a bit and said, "Can't the Kazekage take a much-needed vacation?" Naruto's eyebrows rose in surprise as he then said, "You made Kazekage? Wow, I'm impressed and kind of jealous, since I can't return to Konoha."
"Actually, they rescinded your banishment," Nejai said as he approached the blonde. "You can come back now. A lot of things had changed since your banishment."
Naruto chuckled and looked at Garnet as he said, "I can say the same here, right, Kaz-sen?" The Konoha ninjas blinked in surprise as Garnet then said, "Of course, Naruto, and am you also proud of you, my son?" Gay smiled gently at Naruto's toothy grin as he saw the young boy wrap an arm around Garnet in a loving manner. "So you've finally found yourself a mother," Gay thought it was a warming sight for the Jonin. "I'm glad that you now have a loving mother in your life. If only the Hokage could see you now."
"Say, Naruto-san," Lee asked as he pointed to the gems in Naruto's arms, "how did you recover your hands, and why are those gems in your arms?" All of the Konoha shinobi looked at the blonde, as they last saw him was at the hospital with stubbed arms, and now here he was with hands and using clawed gauntlets. Taking another look, Nejai saw that the embers were in fact embedded in his arms with their own source of energy, a more pure form of chakra.
"Well," said Naruto said as he rubbed the back of his head with a hand, "it's part of my bloodline as a crystal gem, thanks to my ancestor being one of the most powerful gems, Amber or Niseki Uzumaki."
Also helped that you made a deal with the Kibai to erase some of the impurities in your blood in exchange for granting him some freedom every now and then, said a new voice as the shinobi then saw a young man with blood red hair and matching eyes wearing a black suit. I take it you're the Kibai, Nujai said as he saw through the hinge, alarming the other shinobi save for Naruto. The man chuckled as he said, guilty as charged, but don't go spreading it around as I'm only helping the kid with my powers. Name's Kurama as Kibai is just a title. Seeing the look on the faces of the Konoha shinobi, Kurama then said, I know you Konoha shinobi have little trust towards me, what with nearly destroying your village, but can you really blame me if I was hypnotized for a second time? Reaching into his jacket, the possessed clone pulled out his wallet and revealed a badge in his ID. Even though this is an illusion, said Kurama as he knew Nujai could see through the genjutsu, don't just attack me as one, the shadow clone I'm possessing would just disperse, and two, I'm here to help Naruto to keep the fox in check so thereby attacking me won't be threatening the very lives of everyone here. Naruto made the bubble and Jim vanish in a flash of light before he said, I'm going to get us some chow while the others show you to the temple before giving you a tour of the place. Naruto was about to head out when Nujai walked up to the blonde and asked, would it be alright if I join you? I wouldn't mind walking around and seeing the sights myself to get an idea for the Keizukage. Naruto nodded as Nujai followed him towards wherever the blonde was heading with the others following the crystal gems to the temple. Beach City, Fish Stew Pizza. Naruto and Nujai walked in the restaurant after the blonde had shown him a few spots around Beach City. This place is really quite fascinating, Nujai said as he and Naruto approached the counter, but why do they have that dot arcade wizard around if it's evil? That's because Steven tried to introduce his friends to some of the games there, said a dark-skinned girl as she approached the register. Sunny's mother ended up getting badly addicted to one of the games there. Naruto chuckled sheepishly as he said, Mom will never admit it but she felt completely embarrassed about that little incident, Jenny-chan. Naruto motioned towards Nujai as he then said, Jenny, this is Nujai Hyuga, one of my friends back in Konoha. Nujai, this is Jenny, she and her family run this restaurant. Nujai lightly bowed as he said, I am honored to meet a friend of Naruto-san's. Jenny chuckled before taking Naruto's order. After finding a seat, Naruto looked at Nujai and asked, so Naruto-san is it? The Hyuga nodded and said, of course, after our fight during the Chunin exams I had learned the truth about my father and abandoned my ideals of an inescapable fate. Afterwards, I saw the amazing growth you had gone through when you had defeated Sasuke Uchiha and I had also saw the courage you had given Hinata-sama. Aside from my duty towards the head family, I hold you in very high regards and I was actually shocked when I had heard you were banished. Had I been able to help defend you, you would not have been banished for just performing your duty. Naruto crossed his arms and said, it's cool and I really don't blame you for not being able to defend me as from what Kakashi had told me, you and Choji were in pretty bad shape and I really didn't want the two of you to kill yourselves over me. Besides, if every pork chop were perfect, we wouldn't have hot dogs. Seeing the confusion on the Hyuga's face, Naruto then said, it's a saying that Steven's father, Greg, had taught me. So I lost my hands and was banished for doing my job. I was however able to find out more about my bloodline and make such great friends here in Beach City. There's always a brighter side to things in life, no matter how many clouds there are. Nujai smiled a bit as Naruto was somehow able to bring out advice that any philosopher would strive for. You always seem to be the wisest out of us all, Naruto, despite your lack of knowledge sometimes, Nujai said as Naruto's glare gave the Hyuga a chuckle. Nujai couldn't help but think that the Konoha Nine's dream could end up becoming a reality soon. And then some. Well, that's the ending of that chapter. I do hope you enjoy this video. If you like to see more, remember to hit that like button, subscribe to this channel, and leave a comment down below. Until next time.